Welcome to the course on hosting unlimited websites on cloud. This is the first lecture of this course, and here I am going to introduce the few facts about cloud hosting and the structure of the course. So before we start, let's know what are required for hosting websites on cloud. The first thing is cloud server itself. The second one is at least one domain is required, and then a control panel. It could be open source or premium control panel. Although control panel is not necessary, but it is easier to manage when you have hundreds of websites hosted on cloud server. So the question comes, what is control panel? Control panel is an online Linux-based graphical user interface used to simplify website and server management. Some of the popular open source control panels are VistaCP, CentOS WebPanel, VirtualMin, WebMin, Centora, Froxlore, etc. In this course, I am going to use VistaCP open source control panel, which is simple as well as easier to install and manage. So let's know what is VistaCP control panel. As I already mentioned, VistaCP control panel is an open source hosting control panel. VistaCP control panel can be used to manage multiple websites, create and manage email accounts, FTP accounts, MySQL database, and manage DNS records, etc. So let's look at the course structure. The structure of course is something like this. In second lecture, you will learn to get domain and VPS or cloud server, whichever you like. The second is to configure DNS. After that, you learn to connect to the Linux server and then update it. Subsequently, you will learn to install VistaCP, configure VistaCP, and add websites, add users to VistaCP. After that, you will learn to enable SSL for domains installed on VistaCP. Thereafter, you will learn to create mailboxes. After that, you will learn to enable file manager. And at last, you will learn to install WordPress and other CMS. You will also learn to fix errors, to get the answers of your questions, queries, doubts quickly, and how to access large community of VistaCP. So let's get started. Welcome back. In this lecture, I am going to show you where you can get domain and cloud hosting. As far as domain is concerned, you can get it from any domain registrar. It could be GoDaddy, it could be Namecheap, it could be anything. You can just buy domain from any of the domain registrar. Regarding the cloud hosting, you can get it from anywhere as well. But if you ask me which one is the cheapest and best, I will recommend this one. As per my knowledge, if you go to the VPS, you would see it would cost you around 4.99 euro for cheapest plan. If you are planning to host more than 10 websites, then I would recommend you getting this VPS MSSD. Or if you would have more requirement, then you can go for VPS LSSD. However, if you are just planning to host one website, then I would recommend you getting VPS SSD. That would be sufficient for your purpose. So let me show you how you can place your order. So I am going to select this for demonstration. Almost every VPS provider gives you option to select operating system. So you can select CentOS 7, on which we are going to install our open source control panel, which is VistaCP. After that, you need to continue, but first select how many months you want to buy this server for. If you go for 12 months, they will charge no setup fee. Setup fee varies from different VPS cloud providers, so you can choose accordingly. After that, click on order now. Here you have to enter payment information and your personal details. After that, when you submit the order, you'll get your login details like this in your email, where it will say you have IP address this, you have root username and you have password, the operating system which you have ordered for. In next lecture, I will show you to connect to this VPS server and how to update your VPS server. In this lecture, I am going to show you how to connect to your VPS hosting, VPS server, and how to update it. So in order to connect from Windows machine, you need an SSH client, and at this time I am using PuTTY SSH client, which you can just Google and you'll able to download free of cost. And here you can see I have my machine is 64 bits, so I'm just going to download it. I'm just going to copy the IP address which I have just got from cloud hosting provider, and then you'll get this warning. After that, you have to type username root and obviously your password. So after you have logged into your server, you will get this green cursor on your terminal. Let me make it bigger for you. All right. So next I am going to update this machine. For that I have to run this command. I'll prepare the list of command executed in this lecture, in all the lecture basically, and I'm going to provide to you the list so that you can easily install and update your server. So here system will ask you for the permission. All you need to do is to allow, and for that you have to type Y and after that press enter once again. Now this update could take quite some time. In the meantime I am going to configure the DNS of domain. So let's go to the domain. Here you can see I have this learnemail.live domain. I'm just going to click on manage DNS. Now here all the way down you will find host names. Here they call it as host names. In other domain registrar you may not find host names because there are different names of host names. So in GoDaddy they call it host names. In other registrar it could be Blue Records. It could be child name servers, or it could be custom name servers. All of them serves same purpose. So here it is just host name. So I am going to demonstrate you. So in host names, you need to create host name basically, which will be ns1 dot your domain name and IP address like this. Since I already have NS1 NS2 created in past, I'm just going to add NS3. Also one more NS4. However, you don't need to add all those NS1, NS2, NS3, NS4. Just NS1, NS2 is required. I just demonstrated you to add NS3 and NS4. You need not create 4 name servers, only 2 is sufficient. And once you have created name servers, you have to go back to DNS management once again and update the name servers of your domain. So here I am already using custom name servers. Like if I click on I'll use GoDaddy name servers recommended, you'll see like it's lost, and if I click on I will use my own name servers, I can make entry here, ns1 dot my domain name, and after that click save. So you see now my name servers has been updated to ns1 learnemail.live and ns2 learnemail.live. So this is all about DNS modification of your domain, and apart from that you don't have to do anything in domain registrar. So let's get back to update process, and it's been completed. Now I am going to set host name of the server. For that you have to type host name ctl set host name. Let's say I want to call my server box.mydomainname. You can have anything, it need not to be box. So it could be anything, but for the time being I am just setting my host name of server as box.learnemail.live. After that I press enter and my host name is set. If I type host name, then you will see the host name is box.learnemail.live. So I am just going to copy this command for you. The next step is to update DNS resolver, which is on your Linux machine. For that you have to type vi /etc/hosts. So you can see here I already have two entries. To make another entry I have to press A on the keyboard. Let me type here as well. So as soon as I press A, you can see this insert mode is active. Now I am going to press enter, and after that I'll copy the IP address. I'm going to copy localhost. After that I'll make entry of mail.mydomainname. To save this, to save the modification, I have to press escape key followed by :wq, and this is how host names and local DNS resolver of server gets modified. In next lecture I am going to install VistaCP on this machine. See you in the next lecture. Welcome back. In this lecture I am going to install VistaCP on server. So let's open VistaCP and then go to install. If you look at the installation instruction, the first instruction says connect to your server, which we already have done. It says via SSH, and we already have connected via SSH, but the command which it shows is relevant for macOS and Linux machine. We have already SSH client putty through which we are connected to server. So the next is to copy this installation script. Now I have been disconnected from server, I have to open PuTTY once again. this disconnection usually happens when there is no activity for a long time. So now I am connected to server and let me just adjust the settings. Alright, so I am going to install VistaCP now. Installation of VistaCP takes quite some time. You have to continue, yes, and then you have to enter your email ID. And then fully qualified host name. You could see that I already have this host name listed here. So I am just going to press enter. However, if this has not been listed here, then you need to type your host name like this. And then after that, you have to press enter. Now installation will going to take some time. I am going to fast forward this video. And I'll see you when this installation is about to finish. So now installation has finished. I am going to copy this information. Alright, so let's open the admin dashboard. Copy this URL. You'll get this warning, your connection is not private because we are not using any SSL at present. However, we are connecting over SSL. All you need to do is to go to advanced setting and then proceed to this URL. After that, you need to copy the password. So this is how you install VistaCP on your cloud server. In next lecture, you will learn to configure VistaCP. Welcome back. In this lecture, I am going to show you how you can configure your VistaCP control panel. So the first thing you need to do is to copy your domain name and you have to go to edit here. Okay, let's copy it from here and update the name servers. So default name servers are ns1.learnemail.live and ns2.learnemail.live. After that, click save. The next setting you need to do is to add main domain to VistaCP, which is here learnemail.live. And next you have to go to DNS, and in DNS you have to add two records in your main domain. So click on add record and type ns1 and IP. Paste your IP here and then click save. Next you have to enter ns2 and the IP. So now if I go to my Windows machine and open command prompt and type ping, my domain name, you will see the IP address of my server. If you like, you can also ping the host name and you will see the IP address of my server. So next is mail, database, cron, backup, and above in top menu you will see package, IP, graphs, statistics, log, updates, firewall, apps, server. So we'll see usability of all these tabs one by one in upcoming lectures. In next lecture, I am going to show you how you can add websites to VistaCP. Welcome back. If you have been following lecture, then you would have seen in last lecture that I already have added one website inside WebTap. So basically, to add more websites, all you need to do is to click on add web domain and type your domain, and after that click add. So it is that simple to add websites. Once you add website, you will see corresponding DNS records created, and inside mail tab you will see your newly created domain. In next lecture, you will learn to create user in VistaCP. In this lecture, I am going to show you how to create user in VistaCP. So before that, let's go to Packages tab. In here, you can see that there are four types of packages. In first package, which is default package, in which any user can have 100 domains, 100 web aliases, 100 DNS records, and like that everything is 100, disk space is unlimited, bandwidth something like that, name servers. The next one is Gainsborough package. In this package you can see user can have 10 web domains, 10 web aliases, and like that everything is 10. And another package is pale green, slate gray, like that. Here you can see I have 4 packages, but if I want to add more package, I just go on and click add package, give package name, and after that whether I want to allow SSH access, web domains, web aliases, DNS records, etc. So like that I can do the configuration and that packages will be assigned to user. So let's go back to already available packages, and in that I am going to edit pale green package, and I have to change the name servers of this package, and then I'll hit towards user. Here I'm going to create add user, and I'll give username new user. You can generate password, but for the time being I am just going to type the password. I have to also enter email address. So new user @ you can have Gmail as well. It's not like you have to put domain email address everywhere. I could like type gmail.com and then select package. So if you remember, I just updated pale green package. I am going to assign this, and then I have to type first name, last name, and send login credentials. I don't want to send because I don't know whether this email ID exists or not. It's just example mail ID. So I'm going to click add. So this is how a user has been created. Now if I try to log in with new user, I'll able to log in. So new user, so now you can see that user can have less number of features compared to admin. So user can have only like a statistics, log and apps, and he can like add website, he can have DNS corresponding to that website, he can have mail, database, and this thing. So this is how, if you like to have client on Vista CP, you just create user and give user his credentials so that he can add his website and manage all those things. With this, I am going to end this lecture, and in next lecture you will learn to enable SSL for your websites. Welcome back. In this lecture I am going to show how to enable SSL for your website. So you need to go to web, and if you have like new website example.com, then you can only add SSL when this example.com name server has been updated to ns1. Your main domain, which is in my case learnemail.live. So let's enable SSL for this learnemail.live domain. I'm just going to click on edit and then click on SSL support. So you have option like you can generate CSR and then upload that CSR to Komodo or other premium SSL provider, and then they will give SSL key and SSL authority intermediate chain, which you have to paste here and then save it. The another option is to get free SSL from Let's Encrypt. For that, all you need to do is to check this box and it will automatically fetch Let's Encrypt SSL certificate. Also, you have option to enable web statistics. You have two options. You can select anyone, and for access to that statistics authorization, you can create username and password, or you can just simply leave as it is. The another is to create additional FTP. I am going to create additional FTP for this website. For that, let's say in password I am going to alright, so if you want to add any additional path after this you can add, but I am going to leave this field default. After that I am going to save. So this will enable SSL as well as this will add FTP account for this particular website. After that click on save. Now changes have been saved, and if I go back to DNS, I could see like SSL certificate has been enabled, web statistics enabled, and additional FTP has also been enabled. If I click on edit once again, you will see this Let's Encrypt SSL certificate already been added. With this, I have come to end of this lecture, and in next lecture you will learn to create mailboxes. Welcome back. In this lecture you will learn to create mailboxes. In order to create mailboxes, all you need to do is to go to mail tab and then click add account. So here you have option to enter the desired username, and latter part will be added automatically. I mean at the rate your domain name will be added automatically. You can create or generate password, and after that click on add. So just let me save the password. You can create as many email account as you want. In order to log into webmail account, all you need to do is to go to your domain/webmail. Here you have to enter the username, which is email address, and next password. This is how you can create mailboxes and log into your email account. In next lecture, I'll show you to enable file manager in VistaCP. See you in the next lecture. In this lecture, I am going to demonstrate features of VistaCP. So at the top menu of Vista, you can see that we have packages. I already have discussed. Now, the next is IP. In IP, you will find only IP of server is listed here. Then you will see graphs. In graphs, you can see the load average, memory usage, and bandwidth usage, HTTPD usage. Like that, you will see what actually is the load on your system and how your system is performing, whether it is overloaded, you need to take any action, like that. And after that, there is a statistics. So right now there is no statistics because my server is absolutely new. Next, logs. In log, you can see all the modification I made to the server. This was the last modification. I added database and updates. So here you will get information regarding update. You can see that package is already updated. So if there will be any update available, you can update it from here. And there is firewall. In firewall, you can see I have some of the ports allowed for communication to the outside internet. If you need any additional port, all you need to do is to click on add rule and then action drop accept protocol TCP UDP ICMP and the port and then IP address. If you like to restrict SSH access from your home IP address, like if you have a static IP address, then you can make changes to SSH, like accept TCP from only your IP address, not from all over the world. So I recommend you to change this if you have static home IP address. Otherwise, if you have dynamic IP address, then this will cause problem. Next type is apps. In apps, we already have seen Softaculous. Now coming to server, you will see all the services which are active. You can stop or restart services from here. Once you stop, there will be option to start that particular service. Also, you can do some configuration, let's say you want to edit PHP, then go to HTTPD, go to configure, and here you can see configure PHP. In here you can change memory limit, like from 128 MB to 256 MB, and upload maximum file size 20 MB, post maximum size like 20 MB. You can even change it to 100 MB. It's obviously up to you. And then click save. If you ever want to edit file directly, then you can click on advanced option. So here you can do editing as well. So this is all about the features. Remaining users, web, DNS, mail, database, we have already discussed. Yeah, there is one more, like cron tab. Inside cron tab, you can see all the crons. And there is one more tab, which is backup. So this backup runs automatically. You can download this. You can also configure the restore settings. And if you would like to restore settings of these domains which was taken yesterday at this time, you can make restore all. and this will restore the settings of all web domain. If you would like to restore for individual domain, you can just go to that individual domain and you can restore their settings. You have also option to delete, and you have also option to create more backup. So this is all about features of VistaCP. See you in the next lecture. In this lecture, you will learn to enable file manager. In order to enable file manager, you have to open PuTTY once again and then log into your server. In order to enable file manager, you need to execute this command and go to last. After that, you need to press A key on your keyboard to enable editor, and after that, copy this line and paste right here. After that, press escape, colon WQ, and save this file. After that, you have to log out from the admin panel. And then log in back once again. Now here you can see new tab, which is file manager. So if I go to file manager, you will see these are the files listed here. Among all the files and folders listed here, only web folder is useful for you. Double click on it, web, and you will see three domains listed here. If I go to admin dashboard, and inside web you will see that three domains are here. So I have three domains listed here. In next lecture, I am going to install WordPress on this main domain. See you in the next lecture. Welcome back. In order to install WordPress or any other CMS, you have two options. The one is to go to apps, and in here, VistaCP will redirect you to Softaculous, which is quite popular script installer. But in order to install a script, you have to buy subscription of Softaculous. If I click on WordPress, you will see like there is option to install now, but it would say like WordPress cannot be installed in free version. You have to buy subscription. So in here, if you see, they are charging like $8 per year, which is justified if you are planning to install multiple websites or you want to have multiple clients. But if you don't want to spend $8 per year, there is another option, which is to download CMS, let's say WordPress, and then upload it to server, extract it. I'm just going to show you how you can do this. So click on Get WordPress and let the WordPress download. Head towards File Manager, and in File Manager, open the domain where you want to install WordPress. In domain, you have to get inside public_html, and here you have to click on upload. And then you see WordPress has now been uploaded. Next, you have to, my mistake, you have to extract it. Alright, click on extract. Now WordPress has been extracted. Now select all these files and move it to public_HTML directory. I have to type here and then I am going to click move. So if you see, all the files have been moved from here and now all these files are in public_HTML directory. I am going to delete this WordPress zip file, so let me just delete it. Now if I go to my main domain, you see I have been redirected to installation of WordPress. I'll click on continue and then let's go. For installation of WordPress, I need database, so I have to go back to control panel and I have to create one database for WordPress. So click on add database and let's say password, generate the password, click add. After that, click submit. Run the installation. So this is my first website on Vista CP. No, not mine. Your first website on Vista CP. And give the username, the password, let's copy it and I have to like WordPress user, and then enter your mail ID. After that, click install WordPress. Click login. Remember me and login. So you can see that our WordPress is successfully installed. But if you remember that we enabled SSL for this domain name, however, we are not accessing it over HTTPS. So in that case, you need to go to settings, general, and here you need to change the WordPress address, site address to HTTPS, and then you see SSL has been enabled and connection is secure. After that, alright, I have to copy the password. So this is how you install WordPress on Vista CP. And if I go to the website, you see WordPress is running smoothly. You can see I also got one mail. Okay, your WordPress site has been, okay, this is the email address I used during installation. If you want to install another CMS, like let's say Joomla, then again, you have to go to Joomla website and download installation file from there, because once again, it won't, I mean, Septaculous won't allow you to install with free version. So this is rather useless. In that case, you go to joomla.com, sorry, joomla.org, and download Joomla, and then go to file manager, upload it to whichever domain you want, and then you can install another CMS like that. So this is end of this lecture, and see you in the next lecture. Welcome back. In this lecture, you will learn to fix issues with Vista CP. So in order to fix issues, you can ask questions in Udemy Q&A, and there is another way to get immediate solution to your questions, which is through forum of Vista CP. The community of Vista CP is quite large and active, so if you post any questions in forum, you would get instant reply, or you might find that your question has already been answered. So this is the one way to get solution to your problems and questions. Apart from that, you can also ask your questions in Udemy Q&A section. I'll try to answer all your questions as soon as possible. However, I still request you to at least search your problem inside Vista forum or on Google, and you will able to find answer to your questions immediately. So with this, I have come to an end of this course. Let me know in feedback what improvement do you like in this course, what additional can be done, and don't forget to rate this course, as this means a lot to me. Thank you very much.